This is Dr. Max T. Younce, pastor of the Heritage Baptist Bible Church of Walnut Grove, Minnesota. This is our Bible class, and we are glad that you could join with us today. We hope that you will get your Bible out and be ready to follow along. We'll be back in just a moment. Thank you. It is so good to have you join with us again at the same time each week. And again, we count it our privilege to be able to come into your homes and to spend this time with you. We're going to have a message or two on what about women preachers? And you say, oh my goodness gracious, here we go. This is a controversial subject. Well, may I draw your attention to something? When God gives the rules and regulations in the Bible, it is never controversial. The only controversy there is when people do not believe the Bible. And then they say, oh, it's controversial. No, it's not controversial at all. God says, this is the way it is. This is the way I want it. And that's it. So the only controversy that there is if the fact you don't believe the Bible, you refuse to believe the Bible, you rebel against the Bible, and you don't want anything to do with God's Word, whether you're a church, whether you're a preacher, whether you're a deacon, or an elder in the church, makes absolutely no difference. In other words, if it's controversial, it is controversial on the part of the people, not on the part of the Lord. Now, that's very interesting here as we begin to look into this subject here. What about women preachers? We have many churches. We have the Methodist Church that has women preachers. We have the Pentecostal that's saturated with women preachers. And we have women preachers on television. We have them all over the place. But what we're going to confine our Bible study on is women pastors. That's what we're going to confine our Bible study on. We could go into many other aspects of it, but this is the main aspect here. Also, your Lutheran church. Now, when you have three main sections of that, you have the Missouri Synod and the Wisconsin Synod, and you have the ELCA, which is the Evangelical Lutheran Churches of America. The Missouri Synod and the Wisconsin Synod have absolutely nothing to do with having women as preachers, and they do follow the Bible in that respect. Your ELCA is the one that has women preachers, many women preachers, and so forth, and the Wisconsin and Missouri Synod have absolutely nothing to do with the Evangelical Churches of America. I've talked to several of their pastors, and their opinion is that they're just a liberal church, it's a social club, and as far as adhering to the Word of God, they take in practicing homosexuals and several other things that are absolutely contrary to the Word of God, including having women preachers. So you have the Missouri Synod and Wisconsin Synod that have absolutely nothing to do with that sect of their organization. So it and there are other churches also, but what we're going to center on is what does the Bible say and what does God say about women being in the office of a preacher? What does it have to say about that? Now, I want to, first of all, I want to start out, and I believe we need to find out that what people are going to say in the last days concerning the Word of God. So let's go to, if you will here, let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 2. In verses 11 to 14, 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 11 to 14. Now, we're starting right out here with what God says about women preachers, and then we're going to see as we go on here that when God says that there are no women preachers, they're not to teach the men and so forth, we're going to find out that that philosophy of women preachers today is nothing more than a sign of the times. That's all that it is. We're living in the last days where the Word of God, really to many churches, as far as following what God says in the Bible, doesn't mean anything. The churches are nothing more than just a social club, and we'll teach some things out of the Bible, but you will never hear a woman teach on these verses that absolutely prohibit the use of the office of a preacher to be occupied by a woman. You'll never hear that woman teach that to her parishioners, or it would condemn herself. Let's go here to 1 Timothy here in chapter 2, in verses 11 to 14. Notice what it says. Let the woman learn in silence with all subjection. But I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. Now, let's back up here again, and you'll find out that the word is used concerning silence twice, God says it, in here concerning the church. The woman is to learn in silence. She is to be silent in the church. This is concerning teaching of the men. This is concerning the office of a preacher. Let's read it again. Let the woman learn in silence. She's not to be a preacher, but with all subjection. And I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. Twice, God says in the church, concerning the teaching or the office of a pastor, you are to be silent. You are not to teach, usurp authority over the man, and you're not to teach the man. Now, you can teach Sunday school class, you can teach the children, and there are many other things that you can do in the church and that are very helpful to the Lord. In fact, we find out in Romans chapter 16, Paul addresses and commends many women for their wonderful service and dedication and love for the Lord, but we don't find one of them that was ever a preacher. Now, we continue on here, and we begin to look here in the next chapter, which is 1 Timothy chapter 3 in verses 1 to 7. So let's go over here. Now, we find out here that now we have the office of the preacher given as the office, you see. Now, that's very interesting, because we find out in chapter 3, verse 1, verse 10, verse 13, we have the office of the deacon in verses 1 to 7, and then we have in verse 8 on down, we have the qualifications for the office of a deacon. Now, when you study the Bible, you will find out that the word bishop, and that's what is used here. Notice in verse 1, this is a true saying, if a man desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. The office of a bishop. Now, the word bishop there, you know that in the Greek it means overseer. That's exactly what it means. So, you desire the office of a bishop, you desire the office here of a good work. But it is the office of it. It is talking about the office in the church now. Now, notice in verse 10, we come on down, and let these first be proved, let them use the office of a deacon. So it's talking about the office of a bishop or a pastor. Elder, bishop, and overseer are all synonymous words used for the office of a pastor. But we have a different office when we come on down here from verses 8 on down to 13 now. We have another office in the church that is defined as a deacon, the office of a deaconship. So in verse 10 he says, let them use the office of a deacon. And I'd like for you to notice also in verse 13, if you will, he says the same thing. For they that have used the office of a deacon, the office, that is, the office within the church of a deaconship or of the pastorship, you see. So, let's come here and let's begin to find out, as we read in verses 1 to 7, what the qualifications for the office of a pastor is. Okay, let's read it. We find out, we'll begin again here in verse 1, read on down to verse 7 here. This is a true saying, if a man, here we have man, desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, good behavior, given to hospitality, and apt to teach. Not given to wine, no striker, not greedy of filthy lucre, that is, not of filthy money, he's not taking it just to rip off the money as much as he can get out of the church, but patient, not a brawler, and not covetous, one that ruleth well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. If a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he then take care of the church of God? Not a novelist, lest being lifted up with pride that he fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without, and lest he fall into the reproach and the snare of the devil. So there's some interesting things that we want to look at here. And we find out here concerning this that Paul had left Timothy at Ephesus to teach and good, sound doctrine. And we find that out here as recorded here in the first chapter here of Timothy here. So we begin to look here and find out that concerning what this gives here, concerning the qualifications of a woman, you'll find out here that I think it's very, very interesting here, that all the way through here, you find out it is a man. You find that it is in the masculine here. He desireth a good work, the masculine there, and the husband of one wife, and so forth. And you'll find this all the way through here concerning that it is a man and it is not a woman whatsoever. It's very hard for a woman to be the husband of one wife. And yet we have women today that are telling us and so forth, you know, that, God called me to this office and so forth. And I was led of the Lord in order to preach and be a preacher. Well, it comes down to one thing. First of all, how would God and why would God lead you to occupy an office that He give the qualifications and you don't qualify? So it's hard for you to be the husband of one wife, hard for you to be a man, and yet you want the office. You want to occupy an office that God never gave you. And it becomes very interesting here, as he continually told Timothy here, or Paul told Timothy here, to preach concerning sound doctrine, and these are the doctrines of the Bible. These are it. I mean, these are the ones here that that God said, this is what you're supposed to do. So he left Paul here, Timothy, I should say, at Ephesus here, to go there and therefore to ordain and to have, you know, elders in the churches and so forth like that. Now, I'd like for you to notice in 1 Timothy in chapter 1 here, and we'll notice here in verse 2 and 3, unto Timothy, my own son in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. And as I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus, when I went into Macedonia, that thou mightest charge some that they teach no other doctrine. And that is what Paul writes to him under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, because all Scripture is given by the inspiration of God. Therefore, what is penned in here that Paul wrote unto Timothy, that you don't teach anything contrary to what I'm teaching you here. So, if you're going to ordain elders and so forth in these other cities, here are the qualifications for them, and I don't want you to teach any other doctrine. I don't want you to divert from it. I don't want you to water it down. I don't want you to make exceptions. These are the qualifications here concerning the men and the women. And in the office of a bishop or an elder or overseer there, which is the office of a pastor, and also for the office of a deacon, we find out that you got to be the husband of one wife. Now concerning the deacons, we come down here to verse 12. And let the deacons be the husband of one wife, ruling their children and their own house as well. Well, the reason for that God wants you to be married and the husband of one wife is so that in during the counseling and so forth, that you know what it is to be a husband. You know what it is to be married. You know what it is to have children. And therefore, you're much more enabled to give the advice out of personal experience along with the Word of God, because you as the bishop or as the pastor of the church, you have followed the Word of God in correcting your children, in raising your family, and treating your wife the way that she should be treated. And therefore, you're passing that on by experience and by the Word of God to your parishioners to help them with their family. But if you're a woman and you've never been married, or if you are married, then you're putting yourself as the head of the house. You're putting yourself as head of the church, a position that God never gave you. Now, the interesting thing about this is, many women claim, well, they feel called to preach, or the Lord spoke to me to preach, or the Holy Spirit has led me to preach, and so forth like that. Now, I want to stop here just a second, because whenever a woman tells you that, and I've had several women tell me that, well, the Lord led me to preach, or the Holy Spirit directed me to preach. Well, let me just point something out to you. First of all, we're going to find out from 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20 and 21, that the Bible tells us here, no prophecy is for any private interpretation, for the prophecy that is the Word of God, giving forth the Word of God, came not in old time by the will of men, but holy men spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. So all of the Word of God, from Genesis to Revelation, is as the Holy Spirit inspired men to write exactly the words that God wanted them, that He wanted them to hear from Him. So He wrote it down so He wouldn't have to make a personal appearance. Every time you had a question, you could open your Bible, and it'll be in there somewhere if you can find it. It'll be there. But anyway, whenever a woman tells you she feels that she has been called to preach, or that the Holy Spirit has led me to preach. I'd like for you to hold your place, and we're going to find out that that's a lie. That's an outright lie out of hell, and I'd like to show you this. I'd like for you to go in your Bibles back to the Gospel of John, and we're going to find out what the Holy Spirit does. Now, we know that the Holy Spirit, these were holy men spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. All Scripture is given by the inspiration of God. So we're going back here to the Bible here in John chapter 14, and we're going to look here and see what the Holy Spirit does. So if we go to John chapter 14 in verse 26, notice what it says. But the Comforter, that is the Holy Spirit, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, and shall bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. So the Holy Spirit's going to teach you all things. He is not going to teach you something that he has already inspired men to write that eliminated you from having the position of a pastor, and then you're telling me that the Holy Spirit is going to lead you to go against what he's already written. I don't think so. Now let's go to the 16th chapter here and see a little bit more about how the Holy Spirit works, all right? Notice here in verse 13, howbeit when he, that's the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth has come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come, and he shall glorify me. But he will guide you into all truth. Now, the truth is in the Word of God as to what God wants and who he wants to fill the positions that he has created for the church, the pastor and the deacons. Now, in that, when you're telling me that the Holy Spirit has led you to preach, you're lying to me. Now, you may have a demonic spirit that would say, hey, it's all right, just go with the flow of the times, things have changed and everything else, but what the lady is doing is lying to you. She did not be led of the Holy Spirit, so that's the first lie that she's telling you. The Holy Spirit will not lead this woman to have an office that God specifically excludes from the office. She cannot be the husband of one wife. Everything is in the masculine gender. And if he desireth the office of a bishop, he desireth a good thing. That's the masculine pronoun. Everything is in the masculine sense. There is not one avenue open for the woman to have the office of a pastor. So she puts herself in that position, and then, literally, and I know this sounds sort of crude, but it's true, tries to con you into accepting her who is defiant against the Word of God, does not believe the Word of God, or if she is ignorant of the Word of God, I don't know why she would even want to be a pastor. Because the pastor is to be a teacher. So if she's ignorant of this fact, of what Timothy is instructed here when he is to ordain pastors and deacons and so forth, then she shouldn't be a pastor of a church because she is ignorant of the knowledge of the Word of God. So she doesn't even qualify as far as knowledge is concerned. And yet if she does know this verse is in here, or if she's went to some seminary where they accept preachers or women as preachers, then if she knows this is in the Bible, then she's outright defiant. And I've asked many, many, many Lutherans that have women preachers. And I said, and of course they didn't even know there's anything wrong with it because they don't read the Bible for themselves. And the woman is never going to teach you on First Timothy here in chapter 2 where it says, let the woman learn in silence with all subjection. I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usher up authority over the man, but to be in silence. She is never to teach in a group where men are present. She is never to do that. She is not to teach in a church service where men are present. She is not to hold the office of the pastor or of a deacon in the church, because each one of those offices are to be occupied by a man and a husband of one wife. So he is to be married, you see. And that's how simple that it is. So, and I've had, remember one lady told me, said, well, God called me to be a preacher. And I said to her, I said, well, I'm not insulting to you, ma'am, but you just lied to me. Excuse me. God never called you to occupy a position that he never gave to you. So you're lying to me. So it amounts to this. You have those that hire a women preacher. Now, let's go back to the men that are supposed to be the leaders of the church. There's either one or two options. Either number one, you're ignorant of the Word of God, and the qualifications, which you should know if you're a deacon in the church or you're on the pulpit committee. You should know that, unless you just got a social church there just for a social club. But if you want to follow the Lord, then you should know that. And, first of all, you should know that you shouldn't have a woman candidate for your church. Now, if you don't know it, I don't know what in the world you're doing is trying to be a leader in the church if you don't know anything about the Bible, because you're just going to screw up every time you make a decision because you're going on your reasoning and you're not going by what God says in His Word, and you refuse to take it. If you're ignorant of it, you shouldn't hold the position, because the position is supposed to be held by those who know the Bible and know the Word of God and can guide the church and guide the laity and guide the parishioners and teach them what the Word of God says. And here you go hire a woman preacher, you don't know beans from apple butter, truthfully. And how sad that is. And we see that happening all over now. But it's truly a sign of the times that we're in the last days. In other words, I don't care if she's a male, a female, or what she is. Just give me a preacher that'll marry me and bury me. That's just about it. And in between time, we'll have a good time in church. And I'm not going to convict it of any of my sin or anything else like that. And whenever a woman occupies that position, the only way, there's two ways that she can do that and get away with it, is out of your ignorance. Number one, she is so nice and sweet and kind on the outside and on the exterior of her surface to you that you would not think that she would do anything wrong, even going against the Word of God and rebelling against God's Word of her being a pastor. That doesn't even cross your mind. The second thing is, when it comes to this, of being so sweet, so nice, and loving and kind and all of that, is to cover up the fact that God does not want her to be a preacher. He did not give the office to her to be a preacher. Now, since you're not going to be taught the Bible concerning that, and as I've said before, I started to say, I've talked to many Lutherans where they have a woman preacher, and to the congregation, and I said, you know, I want to ask you, did you know that the Bible eliminated any woman to be a preacher? And they're absolutely shocked. And I said, has your preacher ever taught you expositorily on the Word of God and taught you what God said about the office of a preacher? Well, no, not really. No, we've never heard anything about it. Well, do you think that a woman who is defiant against the Word of God, rebellious against the Word of God, and absolutely refuses to obey the Word of God is going to teach you the verses that would condemn her in the Bible? Absolutely not. She's not going to teach you those verses in 1 Timothy chapter 3 here, or 1 Timothy chapter 2. Have any of you Lutherans or your Pentecostals or that? Have you ever read where, let the woman keep silent in silence with all subjection? I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. Have any of you ever read that? Well, I can't find, truthfully, in my talking, because wherever I go, I like to ask questions and find out what people know or what they do not know. And absolutely, this is all covered up by the fact the woman is not in subjection to the Word of God. And if you love the Lord, you would obey the Lord. She does not love the Lord, or she would not be totally defiant against the Word of God that excludes her from being a pastor. She's going to override that. And then she's going to teach you to teach your children to accept her instead of the Word of God. So you're really teaching you, and you take your children there, you're going to teach your children to accept her instead of accepting the fact that she shouldn't be there to be the pastor because the office was never given to her. So, and just as it talks, you know, you when the Bible teaches, like back in Exodus on the Ten Commandments, taking this sin on to the third and the fourth generation. Eventually, on down the line, maybe somebody will read their Bible and find out that, hey, this woman shouldn't be a preacher. Why in the world, Mom, did you accept her? And Dad, you accept her as a preacher. Didn't you know anything? Didn't you read the Bible? Don't you know what the Bible says? And all of this comes down, and I know, here's the first thing that comes. Oh, Pastor Younce, you have got on a controversial subject. Well, let me enlighten you just a little bit. I am not on any controversial subject. It is your women preachers that have defied the Word of God, they've rebelled against the Word of God, and don't tell me they love the Lord when they absolutely will not obey the Lord or adhere to His instructions and seek an office that God never gave them. No, sir, not at all. The controversy is in the rebellious woman who wants a position that God never gave them. That's the problem. And I've heard of women even having nervous breakdowns that's tried to be a woman preacher. And I don't know, maybe I'm not saying that is the reason exclusively, but I'll tell you what, if you know what the Bible says and you know that God never gave you that position, you ought to have a guilty conscience and get yourself right with the Lord and get out of that position and trying to occupy a position that God didn't give to anyone but a man. So you're rebellious. And when you have that and you're trying to pretend like you're goody-goody and all of that and you're going to help people, you need to help yourself first to obey God before you try to present yourself as a leader of other people when you can't even lead yourself. That's the mess you're in, ma'am. Really, if you are that person, you see. Now, we've got some more that we want to say on this, so we'll take one more message and bring out some more things here about the women preachers and so forth. But it's a sign of the times. We'll give you those verses next week to show you. The time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And that's exactly the time you're in before the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. So let me just say this in closing. The most important thing is this. Have you trusted Christ as your Savior? I mean, do you believe that you are a sinner? Have you agreed with God that we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God? And God loved us, and that's why He sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross and to pay for our sin. And whosoever would believe in Him, trust in Him. I trust completely, dear Lord, that You came to this earth and You died on that cross and You was buried and You rose again. You did that just for me. Well, of course, You did it for everybody in the world. But only those that whosoever will put their faith in Jesus Christ will never perish but have everlasting life. Now, we have false teachers all over the place. This world is saturated with them, with the water baptism, confirmation, all of these things here that the church makes up, and so forth, not in the Bible whatsoever. So if you're trusting anything outside of Jesus Christ, you will split hell wide open and be in the lake of fire for all time and eternity. But I thank God that I don't have to go there because Christ is my Savior and Him alone. I don't have to trust a denomination. I don't have to trust women preachers that have already lied to themselves and then they're going to lie to you that that's the office God gave them when He never gave them the office to begin with. So you're really, if you're going to believe the woman over the Bible, then you'll believe anything else she tells you, whether it contradicts the Bible or not. But believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. So I hope that you'll do that and you'll have the peace of God of knowing you have a home in heaven for all time and eternity. Well, our time slipped away. We hope that you'll come and visit us here at Heritage Baptist Bible Church in Walnut Grove. And our mailing address is Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180. Our church service Sunday morning is from 10 to 11, Sunday night from 6 to 7, and our youth group on every Thursday from 7 to 9. We hope you'll join with us, and in the meantime, till next week, we hope you'll keep looking up, because Jesus Christ is coming for His church. As we ever pray, even so come, Lord Jesus.